Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm doing this show from my room. I'm conducting the show right now, and I'm recording this. This show is a show that he's done to present the work of Rachel Avraham. On this show today, we have Rachel Avraham, who's an author and a journalist, who has conducted some investigation into the activities of jihadists in Israel, particularly and more specifically women in jihad. It's a very tough topic, very tough, difficult subject to be dealing with, and her book covers extensively the activities of a particular one case, of which she shall mention, and it covers an issue in which there is not much media coverage. I've noticed, especially living here in the West, particularly in England, we don't hear about women in jihad. We just hear about Jihadi John. We hear about all these Islamic militant extremists doing whatever they do. And it's invariably, in most normal cases, it is the men that are covered. Women in this field are not covered. They're not covered. Nobody covers them. Nobody wants to cover them. It's a tough topic. It's a real tough issue. And above all, it usually results in the press deciding not to cover it. And yet, funnily enough and ironically, you would expect with the emotive means by which terrorism garners support, using the weaker number or the weaker vessel for garnering the emotional support to get the populace to acquiesce to their version of events, you would have thought that women and jihad would be covered greatly, but it's not. This is a show that is for to present Rachel Avraham's book. I hope you like this show. I hope you like the material covered and the questions. This was conducted on my on a media assignment that I was privy to enjoy being involved in, and the media assignment was conducted in Israel. And I was really privileged, I guess, to actually be a party to the media assignment. We conducted several interviews during the course of this media assignment. This is, of course, one of them. And I hope you like the material covered by Rachel Avraham. Enjoy the show, and I will give you a remark at the close of the business.
Hello, good evening, and welcome to the show. Today we are in Israel, and we're going to interview an author by the name Rachel Avraham, and she wrote that book, Women and Jihad. And Rachel is a 31-year-old American that lives in Israel for the last 8 years. She has a little daughter, Lilach. She's two. And Rachel, this is your book.
Mm-hmm.
Can you present yourself to the camera? So, hold it.
My name is Rachel Avraham. I'm a news editor and political analyst working at the Jerusalem Online website, which is the English website of Israel's Channel 2 News. As a journalist, I have been covering terrorism issues for over 3 years now. And as a journalist, I saw that there was significant issues with the way that the media has been covering Palestinian female terrorists. Now, I did my master's degree at Ben-Gurion University in Middle Eastern Studies, where I did my thesis on this topic. And when I entered the journalism world, I saw a need to expand my MA thesis into a book to give journalists a guide on so that female terrorists will not be presented in a glorious light in the media, so that terrorists can be treated as terrorists regardless of their gender, regardless of their national origin, so that the phenomenon will not be encouraged by appeasement in the media. So that's why I wrote the book.
The reason is you chosen woman into that. Why?
Because women are 8 times more likely in the Western media to receive positive coverage than male terrorists.
Glorifying them more than
Because this is how they see it. You know, in Western culture, since you're from the West, you know that women are not perceived in a violent way. They're perceived as mothers of small children, the wives, people that bring new life in the world. If there's violence involving women, it's rape, it's domestic violence, it's murdering women. Women are not villains. The villains always in the psyche of the Western mind have to be a man. So when a woman blows herself up like they did during the Second Intifada, or the female terrorists of today's knife intifada. There was one not too long ago here in Israel who did a terror attack in Jerusalem. Yeah. You know, it's like these particular women are not, you know, the people in the West ask, how could it be that somebody so gentle and sweet could do something so awful, like stab a police officer, stab a yeshiva student, or to blow herself up in a marketplace as people are shopping for Shabbat? What would it be that it would, and then everyone says, oh, does she? She's poor, she's miserable, something happened to her that caused her to do it. She's never guilty for her own actions. Well, if you look at the New York Times and Osama bin Laden, you know, with the September 11 terror attacks, the media was all, had no problem calling a spade what it is, calling him a terrorist what it is. Nobody felt sorry for Osama bin Laden. But Hanadi Jaradat blows herself up in front of a bunch of children eating in a restaurant in Haifa that was owned by partially by Arabs. She's some poor, miserable woman because Israel killed her brother and Israel kills her fiancé. Let's feel sorry for her. But why should we feel sorry for her if her brother and fiancé were terrorists? You know, and even let's just say they were innocent. Is this a way you deal with grief?
Revenge.
By killing innocent children, and some of them were babies? This is not the way you deal with grief. It's not a legitimate way.
Rachel. Second question. You wrote this book about women and jihad. Mm-hmm. The Palestinian movement are talking about the law. No, the idea of returning to all Palestine, Israel, everything,
mm-hmm.
violently.
Mm-hmm.
How do you think that inspire women to go and kill themselves for that cause?
Incitement inspires Palestinian women in the same way that it inspires Palestinian men when they see constant hatred portrayed in their media, in the mosque, in the educational system, by their leadership on social media, when they are constantly indoctrinated this and then
brainwashed
to do this kind of thing. But aside from that, they have another added element that the males do not have, and that is that a lot of these women also have miserable life stories that they might want to get out of. For instance, she could have become pregnant out of wedlock and therefore would be killed in an honor killing anyways. She could have cheated on her husband and therefore would be killed in an honor killing anyways. So why her father could be a collaborator, so she could be killed in an honor killing anyways. So
why not make a big thing out of it?
Yeah, her father could be killed in an honor killing, and a way to redeem herself is for her to become a suicide bomber, and then her father can live. You know, the Sheikh Yassin, and it's mentioned in the book that M.K. Anad Berko did an interview with him that's mentioned in her book, The Paths to Paradise. I quote it inside my book, where basically he said that suspected collaborators can be redeemed by becoming faithful again to the nation, by becoming terrorists, or by having a relative do it. And Ayat al-Akras, her father, was believed to be a suspected collaborator. There's also rumors that I heard from Dr. Kadar, Mordechai Kadar, after I published the book, that the Israeli intelligence claims that she was also pregnant out of wedlock. So so whether she was a suspected collaborator or pregnant out of wedlock, you know, she could redeem her father, who she cared about. She didn't want to be lynched in the camp. She can also was going to die anyways because of a... because she of her situation as being pregnant out of wedlock, so why not get your picture on painted on the school, and to be have
get
posters in all the teenage girls' bedrooms? Why not be die in glory than to just be another statistic in the PA crime statistics?
All these jihadists, or whatever you call them. Do the family get any paid, or they get paid before they do that, or?
Yes, they get paid, and the longer they sit, first of all, the families of everyone who dies get paid for the rest of their lives. And then if you fail and you end up in jail, you also get paid, and the amount of money your family gets rises the longer you sit in Israeli jails, which means if you just commit some mild security crime and get 4 years in prison, your family will get significantly less money than if you commit multiple murders and a suicide bombing yet survive. And then you can get a fortune from the Palestinian Authority. And all of this money that the Palestinian Authority gets, because they don't really have any industry, is via donations from countries like Sweden, countries like the United States, other EU countries. They're the ones who are funding this.
Those payments to the...
If they cut the funding to the Palestinian Authority, where will they get the money to do it? They have no functioning industry. They've invested in terrorism instead of building local industry. The only industry you see in the West Bank is run by Israelis. But, of course, the BDS movement is even trying to shut that down. And I want to add that the main people who are affected by that are Palestinians.
It's the Palestinians themselves.
Palestinian workers.
Rachel, how did the world media... the American, European, and the Israeli portrayed that woman who killed herself?
Well, my media coverage in the book mainly focuses on the American media. I would say that they tend to justify her actions in the name that the misery and despair that the Palestinians are supposedly suffering. Nightline during the Second Intifada was especially infamous in the way that they glorified Palestinian female suicide bombers. For instance, they did a special on the suicide bomber Hanadi Jaradat, where they interviewed a number of Palestinian women, some of them claiming to be human rights workers, and they all said that they admired her for what she did, and that they also would do the same, and that she was more of a victim than the people who were killed in the restaurant with her, and there was no sympathy portrayed for the victim. Another case in point was after the suicide bombing of Ayat al-Akras. There was a young Israeli girl that was killed with her named Rachel Levy. Newsweek did a special where they compared them extensively, and Newsweek showed much more sympathy for Ayat al-Akras than her, because Ayat al-Akras grew up in a slum, while Rachel Levy grew up in the shadow of sleek shopping malls and boutiques in Jerusalem. But what they are forgetting to point is actually, in reality, Ayat al-Akras' father worked for an Israeli company and got a fortune, even though she lived in the Deshe refugee camp, which is surrounded by slums. Because her father made good money, thanks to Israel, he built a three-story beautiful home surrounded by the slum. Well, Rachel Levy's family were Jewish refugees from Morocco, and they lived a more modest lifestyle, even though the surroundings might have been prettier. They didn't pick up on that or care about that, because they're so into the narrative that all of the Palestinians are suffering from poverty and despair and due to the so-called Israeli occupation, and this is what prompts them to do what they do.
But that's the portraying of the world media, I mean, the European media and the Western media.
The European is very similar to the American.
What about the Arab media?
The Arab media glorifies them even more. Wafa Idris, the suicide bomber, was compared to the Mona Lisa in Paris.
Yeah.
They said she was as beautiful as the Mona Lisa. They compared her to Jesus Christ. They compared her to Khadija, the first wife of the Prophet Muhammad, and a variety of other heroines, Joan of Arc, they compared her to. As far as they're concerned, the Wafa Jewish was the Palestinian Joan of Arc, because she killed an elderly Jewish man by blowing herself up.
Rachel, this picture on your book, where is that?
That's a picture of Ayat al-Akras. I got the picture from a source of mine who received the picture from a source, anonymous source, in the Palestinian Authority. And it highlights that UNRWA schools constantly glorify Palestinian female suicide bombers, even though they receive money from the international community to educate for peace.
Yeah, but their theme is peace here. Start here. Is that the way they showing it?
If they're having a picture of Ayat al-Aqsa on their building, they are not promoting peace in any way, shape, or form. The very fact she's holding a pistol shows that she doesn't seek peace.
This picture, where is that?
It's at an UNRWA school in Bethlehem, an UNRWA boys' school.
This picture being taken of many journalists all over the world.
Yes, and it highlights that the UNRWA is not educating for peace like they claim.
Is that Daesh? What's the name of that camp?
Daesha
camp.
Yeah.
What do you think a child think when he go every morning and see that portrait of a murderer with a gun in UN peaceful school? Or so-called peaceful school.
A young child who walks by a portrait of suicide bomber Ayat al-Aqsa in a school, on front of a UN facility school, would be inspired to follow in her footsteps and would feel that the international community would support him in such a action.
Because of all this glorifying of on those camps, in UNRWA camps.
And they continue to send them money.
Exactly. Do you think that this boy that walk around the school every morning and see that, do you think he can inspire his mother or his sister to be a hero like that one?
Of course he would want to motivate his and try to influence his mother or sister to follow in the footsteps of that young person. More likely the sister than the mother.
That's what's happening now with all these knife stabbing. The girls are 16, 17 years old.
Precisely. This picture would prompt a young Palestinian boy to talk to his sister and to try to influence her to follow in her footsteps and to do the same thing.
You mentioned about those girls that come from a slum area, poor area and all that, and that's all media in the world, they're feeling sorry for these girls and all the terrorists. But if you look at the history of all the last 20 years terrorism, they're not Mohammed Atta and all his friends, they come from a rich families or middle class families.
It's very much true what you said. As I told you earlier, Ayat al-Aqsa grew up in a three-story style home, even though it was in a refugee camp. So it was a huge home with all of her siblings. She grew up together in such beautiful standards by Palestinian, compared to other Palestinians. Hanadi Jaradat was a lawyer, definitely not an undereducated person. Ayat al-Aqsa also had straight A's in school. Wafa Idris was a nurse. She wasn't somebody who lacked education. You can't be a nurse without education. So these people are not necessarily poor, miserable. Yes, there was one that was a seamstress who didn't have any education, but most of them were highly educated.
Okay, Rachel, my country contributed
Sweden.
$45 million to UNRWA.
Mm-hmm.
While you were researching for the book and all that, do you know anything about where this money goes?
The money goes to the general Palestinian Authority budget, and that same budget is used to support the families of Palestinian terrorists, including the female terrorists mentioned in my book.
And those who sits in prisons in Israel.
Of course, the failed suicide bombers. Among them, the suicide bomber who killed a cousin of my husband during the Second Intifada, Claude Knapp. He was released in the Gilad Shalit prisoner exchange and is getting financial support from the Palestinian Authority to this day. He survived. He was disabled, but he survived the suicide bombing.
Is this the money that goes from Sweden to UNRWA? It goes to the Palestinian Authority's budget?
it goes indirectly, but it goes to the general Palestinian Authority budget, and from there, some of the pool goes to that.
So then, that we don't know where the money goes.
They don't. They're not stupid.
They're not saying it.
They don't leave a trail. But
we all know that.
We all know where it really comes from.
Do you know anything about the publication about where the money goes and percentage of what and where?
In publicly available documents, it was revealed that 6% of the PA budget is used to encourage terror attacks.
Rachel, the women that you covered and researched on this book, mm-hmm. do you know anything about their mental health, if they were sick and did not get any treatment?
Mm-hmm. Yes, Wafa Idris suffered from depression and bouts of melancholy before she committed her suicide bombing. She started to have these issues after she had a miscarriage and got divorced by her husband because of her inability to have children. The terrorists, who was also mentioned in the book, she was raped by a mentally retarded uncle, Hiba Darame, and she demonstrated clear symptoms of suffering from severe untreated post-traumatic stress disorder.
She was denied treatment.
Her mother told her to cover it up so she wouldn't bring shame to the family, and she became a fundamentalist Muslim. That was her reaction. She wouldn't even expose her eyes. She wouldn't even eat at the university cafeteria with other students because she wanted to be by herself, to lift her veil to eat, and privately because she didn't want anyone to see her face. She even wore black gloves in the summer so nobody could see her hands.
Okay, Rachel. How do we get your book into the public?
You can visit Amazon.com and search up Women in Jihad, Debating Palestinian Female Suicide Bombings in the American, Israeli, and Arab Media, and it pops right up.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I hope you enjoyed that show. I really enjoyed that clip. I enjoyed editing it. I hope you enjoy the editorial work on it. This is a show which I've been wanting to put out since April, and a chance to also showcase the editorial work that I've been doing. Please enjoy, share, and post the show to whomever you wish. Please feel free to share. This show will be live streamed to Ustream, archived on YouTube and posted on Facebook. I hope you enjoyed the show, and I hope to see you next time. Bye.